unlike threatened miscarriage, where pregnancy is still viable and can be saved, inevitable, incomplete, or complete miscarriages are early accidents of pregnancy associated with early pregnancy loss. In this part 2 of my e-lecture on spontaneous miscarriage, I am going to discuss other types of miscarriages such as inevitable, incomplete, and complete. Obviously, it is imperative for you to see part 1 of my e-lecture on spontaneous miscarriage, in which I have discussed the basics such as the incidence, causes, and high risk factors for miscarriage. The link is given below.
My name is Dr. Ajit Virkul. I am a professor of obstetrics and gynecology from Mumbai, India. My subspecialty is urogynecology and pelvic reconstructive surgery. Obstetrics and gynecology is my profession, but teaching is my passion. My area of core competence is teaching basics of obstetrics and gynecology.
A patient with threatened miscarriage has two outcomes. Good prognosis outcome, where with or without treatment, the early pregnancy continues to term or near term. Bad prognosis outcome is when there is early pregnancy loss. The early accident of pregnancy progresses to inevitable miscarriage, followed by incomplete miscarriage, and then complete miscarriage. Sometimes inevitable miscarriage proceeds to complete miscarriage without the intervening incomplete stage being recognized clinically. I have coined a term for this progression. I call this the miscarriage continuum. The clinical diagnosis will depend on the stage of this progression at which the patient presents to the clinic. I will now explain the mechanism of miscarriage. Initially, there is chorio-decidual hemorrhage, which leads to separation of the gestational sac. The decidua capsularis ruptures and the embryo is expelled either entirely or partly. The gestational sac tends to be expelled completely thereafter and the decidua is shed later. If the placenta is completely formed, then the process of miscarriage is like a mini labor. It is more common for the fetus to be expelled, but the placenta may be retained due to firmer attachment to the uterine wall. Inevitable miscarriage or early pregnancy loss has been defined as a clinical entity where the process of miscarriage has progressed to the stage of irreversibility. Incomplete miscarriage or early pregnancy loss has been defined as a type of spontaneous miscarriage where there is expulsion of part of the products of conception. This is the commonest type of clinical presentation of spontaneous miscarriage. On the other hand, complete miscarriage or early pregnancy loss is defined as a type of miscarriage where there is spontaneous expulsion of the entire gestational sac. That is, all the products of conception are expelled out of the uterine cavity. I will now talk about the clinical features of these different types of early pregnancy loss. Inevitable abortion refers to cases in which, after a variable period of amenorrhea, the patient has vaginal bleeding, typically accompanied by a cramping, severe pelvic pain, and on examination, the cervix is dilated. Products of conception can often be felt or visualized through the internal cervical os on per-speculum examination. On per-vaginal examination, the uterus is soft, bulky, and corresponds to the period of amenorrhea. Fornices are clear. Incomplete miscarriage refers to cases in which, after a variable period of amenorrhea, they present with severe vaginal bleeding, often with passage of blood clots. They may also give a history of passage of products of conception. This is accompanied by cramping lower abdominal pain. On general examination, there is severe pallor and patient may sometimes be in hemorrhagic shock. The cervix is dilated and products of conception are found within the cervical canal on per speculum examination. On per vaginal examination, cervical os is open and products of conception can be felt protruding through it. Blood clots and products of conception may also be found lying in the vaginal cavity. Uterus is soft, bulky, but less than the period of amenorrhea. Phonases are clear. Complete miscarriage usually occurs outside a clinical setting, often in the patient's home. A classic history of complete miscarriage is several hours of vaginal bleeding with uncomfortable pelvic cramping followed by passage of a tissue and a decrease or resolution of bleeding and cramping pain. The patient should be examined to evaluate for ongoing bleeding and to confirm that the cervix is closed and that the uterine size is consistent with or smaller than the gestational age. Sometimes, intact entire gestational sac may be seen lying in the vaginal cavity. Pallor may be present. Transvaginal ultrasonography can be done to confirm the diagnosis. The classic diagnostic features are as follows. In inevitable miscarriage, internal os is open, cervix is effaced, gestational sac is irregular, and products lie in the cervical canal. In incomplete miscarriage, internal os is open, cervix is effaced, products lie partly in the uterine cavity and partly in the cervical canal and vagina. Complete miscarriage will show uterus is bulky, cavity completely empty of any products of conception. Remember, ultrasound examination is not essential in every case of complete miscarriage, but may be useful for the patient who continues to bleed or have pelvic or abdominal pain. Sometimes early pregnancy loss can be a diagnostic dilemma. For patients with highly desired pregnancies, it is essential that the diagnosis be completely certain in order to avoid interventions that could terminate a normal pregnancy. In patients for whom the gestational age of the pregnancy measured on ultrasound is substantially smaller than the expected gestational age based on the last menstrual period or conception date, providers must discuss the possibility that the ovulation has occurred later than expected and discuss the diagnostic criteria needed to confirm pregnancy loss. Patients who have an initial transvaginal ultrasound that demonstrates an intrauterine pregnancy without fetal cardiac activity, the diagnosis of early pregnancy loss is based on the following criteria, which achieve 100% specificity and positive predictive value, that is, no chance of a viable pregnancy. These are a gestational sac greater than or equal to 25 mm in mean diameter that does not contain a yolk sac or embryo, an embryo with a crown rump length greater than or equal to 7 mm that does not have cardiac activity. After a pelvic ultrasound showed a gestational sac without a yolk sac, absence of an embryo with a heartbeat in greater than or equal to 2 weeks, or a pelvic ultrasound showed a gestational sac with a yolk sac, absence of an embryo with a heartbeat in greater than 11 days. Please note, in cases of a twin pregnancy, early pregnancy loss is not diagnosed unless both gestational sacs meet the above criteria. This transvaginal ultrasonography picture shows a case of inevitable miscarriage. You can see the embryo dilating the cervical canal. It is about to be expelled. Following confirmation of diagnosis by transvaginal ultrasonography, other investigations which must be done are complete blood count and blood type and cross-matching if necessary. I will now discuss the treatment options. The first thing to do is to counsel the couple. Patient is offered three options, which in order of preference are surgical evacuation, medical evacuation, and expectant management. All three approaches have similar efficacy but somewhat differing risk, and the choice of treatment method depends mainly upon the patient preference, which I will discuss in the subsequent slides. The experience of losing a pregnancy is referred to as invisible grief. Experienced counselor should be able to suggest strategies to help the patient and her partner cope with the loss. Assure them that the grief is real but takes time for it to get over. Tell them it gets easier. It's always there, but it doesn't hurt so much. Role of partners or close friends is also very important. One of the most important facts that she must be told is that it's not her fault. Surgical management is given to those women who do not want to wait for pregnancy to pass spontaneously or with medication, and for those who wish to avoid the experience of pain and bleeding that accompanies the passage of the products of conception. Surgical treatment of first or early second trimester failed pregnancy is dilatation and curettage. This procedure involves dilatation of the cervix if required, followed by removal of the products of conception with sharp curette, followed by suction curettage or both. The procedure is typically performed under intravenous conscious sedation and a paracervical block. It is generally performed in an operating or a procedure room, but some clinicians perform uterine evacuation as an office procedure. Beginning at 16 weeks of gestation, dilatation and evacuation is the procedure of choice. The procedure involves wide mechanical dilatation of the cervix, destruction of the fetal parts, and removal of all tissue with large bore vacuum curette. Second trimester uterine evacuation is typically performed in an operating room under general anesthesia. Ideally, all products of conception should be sent for histopathological examination. Karyotyping is required for women with three or more pregnancy losses. The main advantage of surgical treatment is a shorter time to completion of treatment and is therefore the most preferred method of management of such early accidents of pregnancy. If you want to see details of suction evacuation procedure, especially its technical minutiae, please watch my video part 4 of medical termination of pregnancy. The link is given below. Should curettage be done for every case of complete miscarriage? A complete miscarriage theoretically should not require therapy, but complete miscarriages generally cannot be reliably distinguished from incomplete miscarriages, either clinically or ultrasonographically. As a result, some clinicians perform suction curettage in all of these patients. Others do not advocate this approach due to the risk of operative complications such as intrauterine adhesions, which may compromise future fertility. If ultrasound shows an empty uterus and the bleeding is minimal, no further action is needed. Some women prefer medication rather than expectant or surgical management to expedite the process and potentially increase the likelihood of success. Medical treatment involves giving a combined regimen of mifepristone 200 mg orally plus 800 mg of intravaginal misoprostol after 24 to 48 hours. WHO has a different regimen. They advise giving misoprostol only 600 micrograms given orally as single dose. For more details on medical methods of termination of pregnancy, refer to my video MTP Part 2 Medical Methods. The link is given below in the description box. Expectant management is an alternative for women with spontaneous miscarriage of less than 14 weeks of gestation who have stable vital signs and no evidence of infection. The majority of expulsions occur in the first 2 weeks after diagnosis. However, some women may require prolonged follow-up. They should be counseled about what to expect regarding the process, especially excessive pain or bleeding. Regular clinical and sometimes ultrasonography follow-up is required to ensure that the uterine evacuation is complete. If spontaneous expulsion does not occur after 2 to 4 weeks, surgical or medical evacuation is advised. Following the procedure, prophylactic antibiotics are given. Although ACOG preferred regimen is doxycycline 200 mg daily for 7 to 10 days, we prefer a combination of cephalosporins with metronidazole or azithromycin with metronidazole. Rh negative and unsensitized women who undergo surgical or medical evacuation should receive immune globulin because of the higher risk of alloimmunization resulting from the procedure. Recommended dose varies in different guidelines. A dose of 50 micrograms is effective through the 12th week of gestation due to the small volume of red cells in the fetoplacental circulation. Mean red cell volume at 8 and 12 weeks is 0.33 ml and 1.5 ml respectively. Others prefer the standard 300 micrograms dose because it is readily available. Clinical follow-up of these patients is also important. Ultrasound examination may be useful for patients who continue to bleed or have pelvic or abdominal pain. Surgical and to some extent medical evacuation is associated with the following complications: during surgery, anesthesia-related complications, excessive bleeding, perforation of the uterus, and rarely other surrounding tissues, and cervical trauma. Incomplete evacuation, infection. Late complications are infertility, intrauterine adhesions, and of course, not to forget the important psychological trauma. This brings me to the end of part 2 of my e-lecture on spontaneous miscarriage. I hope you have enjoyed watching it as much as I have enjoyed researching and making it for you.
If you want to study more about this topic or any other topic in obstetrics and gynecology, please read the following books written by me: Practical Obstetrics and Gynecology, Modern Obstetrics, Modern Gynecology, Clinical Cases in Obstetrics, Questions and Answers, Clinical Cases in Gynecology, Questions and Answers, and Pelvic Reconstructive Surgery, a monogram on pelvic organ prolapse. For purchase inquiries, contact me at email given below or ping me at the WhatsApp number mentioned below. Also, please subscribe to my new YouTube channel called Modern OBGYN that deals with basics of obstetrics and gynecology, and press the bell icon to get regular notifications about new uploaded videos.
Also, follow me on my Facebook page Modern Obstetrics Gynecology and Instagram handle Modern OBGYN. Thank you.